because of the eyes in my headphones,
slow on my
brushing. The internet is interesting because it allows you to listen to your favorite songs on repeat. But when it just stops, it can be an odd pause. But clearly necessary. It is not always up to us when to begin things. But we can, God bless you, answer and say yes, Lord Jesus. Or we can complain and say, turn the music back up. I thank y'all so much for being here. Each and every one of you. Please smile at your neighbor and say hello if you have.
Good afternoon to all. How are
you? Good afternoon.
Oh, this is like the church. All the response. Good afternoon to all.
Good afternoon.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Thank you so much for joining us today. I am Jeremiah Ojo. I have the honor and the great pleasure of hosting this conversation in the gallery here at Richard Beavers Gallery. I have had, again, the honor to be able to work with Richard Beavers and Genesis Tramaine on this exhibition. And we're gonna dig deep into the work. We're gonna talk about the historical, the cultural, and the visual significance of this body of work and what it means, not just to Genesis, the gallery, but most particularly to you, the community. So we're going to take this opportunity to get to know Genesis a little bit more. So we wanted to make it a little fun and a little non-traditional. So we're going to do rapid fire questions.
Okay.
Yeah. Just a couple things just so you can get to know some other idiosyncrasies about Genesis. And then we'll get right into the talk if that's all right. Sound good?
Sounds good. Yeah.
All right.
There's a beautiful woman coming in.
Oh.
Rapid fire questions. Is that what we were? Let's go.
Okay, I'm ready.
First question. Just because we had the sonic quality kind of ushering us into the spirit when we began, what is your favorite song?
My favorite psalm
is,
that's what I heard first, that's what I'm going to answer. My favorite psalm is 139, because it allows me to be me, and it reminds me that it's my job to be all of me, because God made me this way. For a long time, I've tried to stretch and pull and push into different types of skin, and you know, it's a ridiculous dance, really. Eventually, I got my rhythm together. You did, brother. And Psalm 139 is what keeps me going. I read it just about every morning. If it's not that one, it's Psalm 91. Mm-hmm. My favorite gospel singer is Maurette Clark Brown and Richard Smallwood.
Awesome. That was rapid. All right, wonderful. Since we are in Brooklyn, Bed-Stuy specifically, just to get a better sense, because you are from Brooklyn, what is your favorite part of the borough? Favorite thing, favorite part, place?
My favorite part of the borough is my grandmother's kitchen. That's a good question.
And why specifically?
Because her coffee is always proper, always there, always right. My mug is always ready. It doesn't matter where I'm coming from or how far I've traveled or what time of day I get there, it's ready. And she's always got a story for me. And it can beat anything or any adventure that I think I can top at her table. So I would say, Nana's kitchen.
I love it. I love it. All right. Let's get a little bit more granular and talk about where we are in this space and the work about. Do you have a favorite piece in this series, Hebrew Boys?
No, I don't. But I have had favorite moments in within process. I've had very high moments. And I learned very, very important lessons, and I'm grateful to, you know, for those high days and those, and I'm also grateful to the God we serve for those tests that push us, you know, and remind us of who we are in those low days. So those are probably in retrospect the moments that I'm greater and grateful for. But favorite work? No.
Okay.
No.
No problem. Favorite color?
Black.
I dig it.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, yeah.
I love it. All right, favorite movie.
Oh, that's really, oh, come on. So, if we're to know, I'm a movie buff, first of all. I absolutely love cinema. I think it's brilliant. I think it's one of the most brilliant inventions of all time. I'm so grateful that I was born during the time of TV and television and things like that. More blessings and saints. My favorite movie. Growing up, my favorite movie was Sparkle, the original.
How many Sparkle lovers in here?
Giving him something he can do. And then as I got older, my favorite movie, was Rocky. Part four is probably the training. I can watch it on repeat. But anyway, Rocky, I would say probably up there.
Okay.
You can keep going, but those are the ones that I'd be honest with you.
Favorite food? Does this go back? Whatever.
I love pizza. I also really love macaroni and cheese.
That's right.
Yep, a lot.
Yeah.
Probably too much. I just asked my mother-in-law on the way here to make a personal sign for me for Thanksgiving. And what she doesn't know is I've also asked my mother to make a sign for me on Thanksgiving, and that list usually continues. But that's my snack, at night during painting often. Yeah.
I love it. So now that we've gotten to know you a little bit more personally and somewhat informally, let's get to know you more formally.
Okay.
Tell us who you be. Who are you? Where are you from? What do you represent? What do you believe?
Oh man, my name is Genesis Tramaine, and my mom gave me that name specifically. Oh wow, that's amazing. I'm from Brooklyn, New York, born and raised in Lafayette Gardens. I was raised by five of the strongest women that I know. And I'm grateful for every brick that has gotten me to where I am. I believe and serve our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, thankfully. Blessed be the rock that I serve. It is that salvation that all of this is possible. That continues to be possible. You know, that's my cornerstone. That's my morning grace. That's my sweet potato pie. You know, Jesus. I get choked up because I really love Jesus. You know, seriously, it's a very sensitive relationship that I'm truly, truly just grateful for and blown away by. And it's like meeting a first love. Truly, yeah. Again and again. So, my beliefs lie and stem from there.
Wonderful. And one of the reasons some of you may wonder why I'm the one in conversation with Genesis is we do have a kinship, a spiritual kinship. Okay. I too, much like herself, I'm a Jesus freak. I love Jesus. Yeah. Can I get an amen?
Amen! Amen. That's what I like. Amen. I'm proud of Jesus.
Proud Jesus freak.
I've been called a lot of different freaks, and one day I just realized, wait a minute, I can't, hold on. Wait a minute, that's what it is, and let me figure out why you're calling me that.
That's right.
And now I just understand they forgot my first name, or, he's gone, brother. Jesus freak. Yeah.
That's right. So, having the great benefit of working with Richard and Genesis during this exhibition, we thought it, perfect opportunity to talk about this body of work, Hebrew Boys, and Portals of Faith, and what it means to not just Genesis, but the community. Part of what Richard Beavers Gallery represents is educating and inviting people from the community to understand themselves better through the artwork, the artists, the exhibitions, and the programming that is accelerated here in the gallery. So we're going to take some time to really talk about some specific works, the context. I'm an art history guy, so I'm going to throw a bunch of art history language, feel free to raise your hands towards the end for questions, but this is going to be a dialogue, and we're going to learn some things. I'm going to learn some things about you all. Genesis is going to share and also learn some things, and we want it to be fun. So thank you again so much for joining us. Genesis, what does this body of work mean to you?
It means the world to me. It's a great blessing to be called into assignment. And when that assignment is recognized by others in any capacity, it becomes something that, I don't really have words to extend around meaning to me, but it's a great decision. It's a decision also to jump into that space, that commitment to get the assignment done from beginning to end. I'm wowed. God is wowing me, blowing my mind, truly. It's beautiful, and I'm grateful for every last stroke. I really mean that. It was hard, it was a great test.
Yeah.
I'm grateful. Assignments are, I didn't know necessarily that it was the story of Daniel that I was going to dive into, but I did know that it was around male yeah. saints. It's a different cry, it's a different breath, if you will. It really pulls from a different space within self as well.
Yeah.
So I learned.
Or so
I was reminded of during this process. So very grateful.
And you speak very specifically about the inspiration behind this book of Daniel. And biblically, we understand Daniel and... the title of the exhibition is Hebrew Boys, Portals of Faith. And when creating this body of work, she and I and Richard sat down and had a dialogue, sat in front of the work in the studio to get a better understanding of what she was drawing from. Yes, biblical scripture and the power of these three Hebrew boys, or men, really, and the context to which their faith was tested. But more specifically, we looked at each individual as a saint and a portal. And these portals are reflections of each of us as individuals. There are signs and symbols embedded and encoded in each one of the pieces, and Genesis, I feel, masterfully captured various visual vocabularies that took me on a journey of understanding African traditional storytelling techniques, but also creating her own visual language, right? And part of me also understanding her, understanding my faith, was embarking on a journey of visual literacy, right? So understanding the forms, the symbols, the signs, the colors, the tone, the volume, and what it not just meant to myself, but to her. And am I part of that audience? And who is in that audience? So when we decided to title the show Hebrew Boys, Portals of Faith. I know you spoke very specifically about them being portals, right? That, you know, this large scale portrait was something that you engaged in. Can you talk a little bit more about actually creating this body of work and some of the signs and symbols that you...
Only a little bit.
Yeah.
I can only share what I know.
Right.
I always say that I don't know where they take me. Oh, blessed be. I don't know. Welcome. Sorry, I'm so excited. I don't quite know where they take me when it's time to work, Brother Jeremiah. I just know that I'm safe. I know that I'm in a very, very good space and that it's okay to surrender. That's what I know. It's the assignment truly is a call of surrenderance. I don't know if that's the word, but it's a height of it's a new surrender.
Yeah.
That's what it is.
Yeah.
So it's pushing yourself to a new level so that you can surrender at that new level.
Yeah.
So once I decide to answer that in assignment in prayer, I don't know. You just I've had to be really honest about my process recently. One of the things that's, I'm really grateful to the team that I work with, guys. And it happens to be, I'm going to be really, really, get really, really vulnerable and be really honest for a minute. Okay, is that cool with everyone?
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm a proud woman, female saint, in service of our Lord and Savior Jesus. And I happen to be queer by nature here, as I'm classified in this land. And I believe that what that allows me to do is stretch spiritually in a way that most people run away from, if you would. It's almost my superpower, if you would. In doing that, I learned of a new valley. I learned of a space spiritually where the boys play, if you would. And I spent time there in research and studying. In order to get there, there are spaces within myself that I have to push myself to get to. I have to dismiss worldly spaces and worldly things, and it took me a long time to figure out what that meant. But that's very personal for me. For me, that meant I could only have one cup of coffee a day. That was actually very difficult for Brother Jeremiah. There's a discipline in reminding yourself that the answer is no in order to get to the next level. The assignment is very loud, it's blaring, it's what pushes you to answer that call of discipline. But it's a portal because it's a space within myself that it's a new space.
Yeah.
I fought really hard to get to and to paint consistently from and to produce from and to be used from and to grow from. And I met a story of deliverance. Daniel, and do we know the story of Daniel and the Hebrew boys? Is there anyone by hand who would be brave enough to say, I've never really heard that story? Is there anyone brave enough? Thank you so much for being honest, because it's important. So a couple of years ago, I'm gonna tell you what called me to a portal in the first place, okay? And then we're gonna scale back to why the word portal both excites me and scares me. Mm-hmm. A couple of years ago, dare I say, darling, goodness, my wife and I, we lived through a fire. I smile because we lived through a fire, meaning we were challenged in faith by fire. And we lost everything, bless God, except the paintings. The story that I fell upon was Daniel, to pull myself up from here to a space where I could stand up and speak and move and be cool with it. When I look back, the space of fire, the space within the fire that I remember, first of all, I barely remember it, which means it was a space of grace. I barely remember this happening, truly. I don't have any real effects other than the story that I'm telling you based on that fire. Mm-hmm. So I found truth in what I was reading in the story of Daniel and what reflecting what I had been going through. So. Daniel is this guy, he's this man. Well, first let's start back, let's render back a little bit. All right, there's this king, his name is King Nebuchadnezzar. I love the idea of King Nebuchadnezzar. I imagine that he walks this way, King Nebuchadnezzar. It was said by some that he was a very debonair man, if you would. He held charge. He was always in charge. Does that make sense, brother? Wherever he went, he was in charge, right? King Nebuchadnezzar decided to go into this kingdom that wasn't his, brother. He said, you know what? I want all the king's seats. All of the king's seats. I want princes. I want you, because you're the sharpest one here. I want you, because you're tall. I want you, because you wear glasses and have a beard. I want the ones with the beard. That was how specific this king was, right? And Daniel and the boys, quote, quote, we're going to hold boys in quote, were a part of this group of slaves, of captives, if you would, that were taken from a kingdom. They were stripped of their culture, okay? They were stripped of everything that they were stripped of their names, and they were told how to behave for 3 years. Sound familiar?
Yes.
Strikingly familiar. This ain't even got nothing to do with my fire. So naturally, I come out of this fire, and I'm like, man, these boys been.
Well, what else is going on, Jeremiah? So I get a little deeper. And I argue and tussle with this king, Nebuchadnezzar, for variant reasons. But I get back into the story. The king has a dream that no one in the kingdom can tell him the meaning of. He calls on Daniel. We can go back into the background of why in particular he calls on Daniel. But he calls on Daniel because Daniel is the only one who what can do it?
Yeah. Interpret.
Excuse me?
Interpret the dream. Right?
Interpret the dream. Not only could Daniel interpret the dream, but Daniel also told him the dream, right? Mm-hmm. He was able to tell him the exact account. Mm-hmm. Which meant Daniel went into prayer with his bros. They got on their knees, and they prayed, and they prayed, and they prayed, and they prayed until their prayers were met with an angel. Daniel was visited by an angel, and that angel told Daniel the dream, and then Daniel told the king the dream. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. Prior to him telling the king the dream, the king was killing all of the wise men. So Daniel also did this in efforts to save who? Other brothers. Right, so it was the first circle of fire, if you would, of prayer, if that makes sense. First he freed others. Before he was freed from his own fire, Daniel freed others. So that's the first lesson I got. Before we even get to the story, I was like, whoa, hold up, I can really just pray with my homies. God bless you, babe. Yeah. I can get down on my knees with the ones I love, mm-hmm. and I can pray for others mm-hmm. who are going through it, and the Lord freed me. Mm-hmm. Wow. God bless. That's how abundant the blood. It wasn't even, so this hell wasn't even present yet. To be honest, I had just come out of prayer with the mother. I didn't quite know where we were going. I didn't know. I just got in front of the painting, I just got my stitches ready, but I didn't really know where we were going at that time. But I kept going, and I realized that in this process, like Daniel, and in prayer, prayer is a movement.
Yeah.
And in order to go through a portal, you have to travel, right, sir? Yeah. So in order to get from where I am to where God needs me to be, I have to physically travel. I must be going through something. Mm-hmm. I'm not standing where I was. I certainly don't feel the way I just did.
Right.
Something's going on. Yeah. Lord, what's going on? I can't even stop moving my body. Seriously. I'm grateful for the paintbrush. Y'all would call me crazy if I didn't have one. I promise you. You see how you laugh a little bit? Because I could be, right? Right? If I allow myself to get crazy, meaning surrender, let go of your ideals or what you might think of me in that space and completely surrender, yeah. well, then I'm called to a space where I'm weak.
Right.
And I have to what? Lean further into prayer until I'm pulled back into a what? Vision or space. And then I can do something that can only be done by the hand of God. Because I'm not where I was.
Yeah, that's right.
And I have something that I didn't have.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody, I didn't do it. I didn't push myself. That would be weird. That's against the force of nature, literally.
Yeah.
So then what's going on, Lord? I did not ask, Brother Jeremiah. Mm-hmm. I just go.
Mm-hmm.
Now when we met around the word of portu, it sounded closest to what I felt like I was going through. And I love to see myself as a Mary Jane and a Superman.
Mm-hmm.
So I am going into a space, like a kingdom,
mm-hmm.
like a garden, mm-hmm. like the greatest hug you could ever imagine. Like hugging your grandmama.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
And like, it's amazing. You know how, like, when you hug Nana, you don't really worry about how many seconds pass,
mm-hmm.
right? You don't know where you go for that second, you just know you're safe.
Right.
It's the same way. So, it's a portal because it's I'm traveled. I don't know where I'm going. I'm traveling somewhere, brother.
Yeah.
It's a portal because It is a prayer occupied within a space. Does that make sense? That I can then, thank you, Lord, I can then help to free others through.
Yeah.
I can pray for others like Daniel, bless the heavens, thank you, Lord, right? And not just free myself from this fire, but I can free others. So y'all called it for, and I was like, cool, that works. But that can also be very limiting.
Yeah.
I don't like that. But that's that human-ish. It ain't really about what I like, Brother Jeremiah.
Yeah.
So then I took the word back into prayer. You know, and I you know, we sung together and danced together. And then they are Hebrew. Mm-hmm. I put boys there to draw attention to them, because that's mostly how they're recognized, unfortunately. Still, these were grown men, by the way.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. These were not boys. But in history, we're often called boys, but we are men, right?
Yeah.
So it was no different there than it is now. You know, I don't think Trump is as cool as King Nebuchadnezzar. I don't think he walked the same way, but he may occupy his land in a very similar way.
Yes.
Where, you know, snatching a specific culture from a people and trying to move it in, you know, in a way that, quite frankly, is outside of a reign that we readily recognize and understand.
Yeah.
And just because this time around it's not readily Hebrew doesn't mean that the Hebrew or black or African man is not being greatly or greater affected by this. So it's important to draw attention to the spiritual portals. Around the work, but it's also really, it's relative work. Like, this is the reflection of what we, a lot of our boys are in captivity, unfortunately, stripped from every script, their names taken from them, forced to do things they shouldn't have to do, and expected to keep a smile on their face. I've never understood that. Nobody can ever take that story from me, because back to that eloquence of that superpower, if I may be a little bit more vulnerable with y'all, if I put my hood on and I walk out a certain way, y'all will think I'm a dude, depending on how I walk my walk, you dig? So this allows me to really, really breathe within what I'm truly called to do. Not saying that I'm a dude or that I think I am, but unfortunately, we're assumed to all look the same way, right?
Yeah.
And so I can't help but to pray for black men who are held in captivity and do my very best in prayer to free as many as I can. That's a grave assignment. How does that feel? It's scary, it's nerve-wracking.
Yeah.
What if I get it wrong? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But I ain't gonna get it wrong because God wouldn't, so it's cool.
Yeah.
But it's hard, you feel me?
It is, and to that point, you touched on a number of things and some things that I want to specifically highlight. In our dialogue about titling the show, the body of work, or even individual pieces, you created them without any of that given. You just create. And part of our responsibility, me, Richard, community, is giving context, because you're a vessel. The same way Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego, and Daniel, right, were vessels. They were tested. They resisted authoritative power, and they stayed true to what they believed. So with this body of work, Hebrew Boys Portals of Faith, it is a test of faith, and it's understanding the nuance of your belief. Whatever that may be, you are now faced with this visage. Several of them, faces larger in scale than your own, and you're forced to come to terms with the things that you believe or don't believe. So when we look at this work, I made reference earlier that unbeknownst to yourself in many instances, because you're just a vessel, you pray, you act, and you move, right? And with that, particularly this style, this visual language that you've employed, has its historical lineage from West Africa, which we'll talk about in a moment, from Adinkra symbols and Sidibe and other African indigenous languages and forms and symbols that communicate certain feelings, context, stories, that are all embedded within these portals, right? So you're looking in someone's face. Everyone look to your left or your right, find a neighbor and look into their eyes. I know this is extremely intimate, but it's important. It's very hard to hate someone and hurt someone when you're looking in their eyes. Because there's a radical sincerity, regardless of your color, belief, understanding of yourself, yesterday, today, or tomorrow, you are faced with their humanity just as much as yourself. So the power of what she's created with it, each of these bodies of works is not just eyes, right? But if we look at it, so we're looking at Mother of Saints. It's the first piece that you see when you come into the gallery. Making reference to specific aspects of the work here, you see symbols, you see forms, right? Some may say they're eyes, but through further analysis and understanding visual literacy, just like you have to read words, you have to read images, right? So there's a sonic quality to looking at these things. There's a rhythmic and a gestural pattern that you see. And these kind of circular forms that have dots in them are both birds and fish. Can you all see that?
Yes. Jeremiah, don't tell all of
you. All right, I'll save some things. But I wanted to highlight specifics of things that, just on the onset, some of us may be, you know, scholars of art or just visual culture altogether, but it's important to learn how to read images, you know? And part of that is building a literacy, a vocabulary of language, not just what we give you, but coming to us and saying, hey, this is what I see. Based on where I'm from, this color, this form, this line, right? This tone, this contrast means something very specific to me.
Can you put the sparker back over, just right there. Can you move the cursor from it so that we can see the symbol there?
Right,
there we go, perfect, brother. Can everyone see the portrait there? Put your thumb up if you see a portrait there. Did you see it?
Yes.
Did you see it prior to the scope?
No.
No, right? Yes. So similar to where God always asks us to not look at each other, not just at the outside, right, but look at ourselves deeper so that we can really see ourselves and see each other. You gotta look at the work as deep as you can, right, and challenge me to you know, so that I can really challenge the space within my prayers and process, because it's for all of us. Go back. They told, when I was your age, where are my chickabees? I have another one there, your age, my dancer. They told, has everyone heard of the Sphinx? Mm-hmm. What did they do to the Sphinx?
It's terrible. Anyway, I laughed at points of history to keep from crying, so bear with me. But I put an infinity symbol here, Richard, across the nose, because they can chop it off this time, brother, but the infinity symbol means that we are as black as we choose to be, on and on and on, and as African as we choose to be, on and on and on, and that nose is as spread as wide as it chooses to be, on and on and on. And so I listen as far as I can to the angels to be present and honest. And for some of the symbols, I'm very present, I am, but for most of them, I'm not. That infinite symbol is something that you will see traced throughout my work, but it's with great intention. Symbolism is very, very important. It's an easy space to get lost in when creating, to get distracted in when creating, and to lean into, but it's also a really, really great way to communicate, for us to communicate. So some of the things, you know, we not gonna understand necessarily right now, but if I'm used the way I know I can be, and the way God is really choosing me to, then the Twinkies, the angels in the room, they'll understand it, and they'll be able to tell us about it, and tell others about it. And so my job is not necessarily to understand the symbols, you know, or
or I don't question the why. I brought attention to that one because it's one of my favorites.
Right.
And I said I would be vulnerable and share, but the reality is it's not really for y'all. It's for them. Mm-hmm. Y'all don't understand what they're doing now on these phones nowhere. But believe it or not, that's all gonna be corny. That's gonna end real soon, just like everything else. Phones is gonna be corny, y'all.
Right.
And they gonna fall back on what? What we always fall back on, dancing, ball, art, culture. So if I'm doing it right, it's okay if y'all miss the message. Mm-hmm. I expect y'all to, with all due respect. It's not my job to push out an interpretive to try and get you guys to understand and sort of see what I see. And, you know, I really struggle in creative spaces. If you'll notice, really big shout out to Brother Richard Beavers in the space, but if you notice, we're going to get back to that shout out, but if you notice, we chose this time around to not include the interpretation of each work. I'm sure you can get that info if you dig into me and we can talk further about it and stuff. That's available, right? But like, y'all are brilliant. And if I'm doing it right, if I'm truly a vessel, I'm still learning from this assignment. I'm still receiving from this portal.
Yeah.
It just extended. The portal is open to you guys even further now. You chose to be here. So this is not about me. Just if I keep removing myself, I'll get it right. Truly.
Yeah.
Right? So with the symbols and stuff, I'm grateful to God that it gets down. Mm-hmm. And that I'm chosen to put it down. And I'm grateful to God that y'all bring these beautiful angels here to absorb. They're smarter than us. They can do things. They can be on their phones and still hear and know what's going on. It's eyes weird. Mm-hmm. I'm serious. They're smarter than we are. So I don't have to talk to them. I can leave communicative symbols that are going to make grave sense to our children and the next generation.
Yeah. And that's such a great point, because when you look at history, and the history particularly of African storytelling, mm-hmm. It has been oral, but it's also been visual. And oftentimes they will tell us, because they try to write our history, but our history has always been encoded in our hands, in our wide nose, lumosity in our skin, our walk, our swagger. It's packaged and being sold every day to us, right? So when we understand the history of how we tell stories and preserve history, our history, it's not overt. It's not directly told word for word. They're symbols, they're forms, they're colors, they're textures.
Their feelings, their gestures, their emotions. Y'all know what y'all mama mean, whether she say it to you or not.
Yeah.
And you better get it right.
That side eye.
like, you know what I'm saying? Like, it's very interesting when people speak to me about my training or process. It ain't changed since I was at my grandmama's kitchen at LG Projects.
Yeah.
To God be all glory for Valerie Frederick. I wouldn't be here without her.
That's right.
But she don't necessarily write it down properly, if y'all will. Y'all understand what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
But I bet you I got the lesson, didn't I?
Mm-hmm.
And didn't God push me further than God God necessarily opened her portal? Ain't my portal opened a lot wider?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So we ain't necessarily got to write it down in a way that they understand.
Yeah.
Or that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Just be available and get it done.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's it.
Yeah.
The other stuff is like, it's very human.
It very much is.
It's very,
yeah.
It becomes very trivial, to be honest with you. But let's keep the lessons that have bred us.
Yeah.
And let's really, really respect ourselves as artists and creatives and lovers of the art and collectors of the work and respecters of the work and process and those great things, because they're going to get it.
Yeah.
If I do it right.
Yeah.
God is. If that's the whole gist of it all, for real. That's the point of it, is to be available for the next. To help the next. My dreams have, I, this is, I'm, this is, you asked about feeling, I don't know.
I'm busy, I'm working, Brother Jeremiah. I've been called to a grave assignment. I don't necessarily have time to, quote unquote, enjoy. I have work to do. Mm-hmm. Period. I woke up to grits this morning. To God be all glory. I ain't got nothing to complain about. But when my mother-in-law finished the meal, she didn't necessarily properly call me to her table. But I bet you I knew the grits was ready, y'all. Art, for me, has always been how I communicate spiritually with our Lord and Savior, always. Yeah. I didn't necessarily know that that was the language that God was communicating to me through. I didn't think that it was okay to be found that way. I didn't know it was all right.
Yeah.
I didn't know that God could exist in a paintbrush. I didn't know that God was like under my desk or in my book bag or like, I didn't know that God was that available to me. Mm-hmm. So once I found out, like I don't have to tell y'all my secrets. Like it's really, I don't have to say. I'm serious. I'm dead serious. Like for real. So I don't have to sell anything. I don't have to give anything away that God gives me. I'm grateful that God gives this to me. So it has to go somewhere. And I believe that these are not just paintings. They're like gospel hymns, if you would. If you listen to old gospel, there's a reason why your spirit can't be contained when a gospel hymn is played. Not gospel music, a gospel hymn. There's a reason why there are certain colors that grab your spirit whether you want them to or not. They were here before us, you feel me? So it's a message in the color. Whether I wanted it to be blue or not, there's a message there. I tried very hard, very hard. I prayed very hard for God to extend the blue so that I could wrap around each portrait in the same way. And they said no. It's not about me. None of this is about me. None of it. None of this. 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 And so we have to be okay with getting the work done even when you don't really understand. You have to get really comfortable with being really uncomfortable when working under the Lord and Savior. It is actually the flight of grace, if you allow it to be. But I'm telling you, it can also feel like there are 1,000 dragons pulling you down. I get that too. I live there, truly. But it is there that I met Daniel again. I didn't go through that fire alone, my wife and I. I had a friend in prayer that I could lean on. And then I had a story that really, really made sense.
Yeah.
And it gave me a direction that really turned on a lesson for me that really, really just made sense in the studio, in my kitchen, you know? So, you know, I took the ingredients that I was getting, Brother Jeremiah, and it was blue and white. And I kept going.
Yeah.
Right? Because it's going, y'all get it. Right? Even if I don't, the Lord has called me to do it, so I'm going to do it.
Yeah.
And I don't have a question if my people don't get it. Because y'all get it.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
And we ain't got to give our shit away.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Right. Thank you.
So I expect for it to be understood. You feel me?
Yeah.
God wouldn't have gave it to me if it wouldn't be.
Right.
And I've learned in studying the word, the Bible, and Daniel, they call them different names, and they won't even tell them that they were African men.
Right.
So I know they're twisting up the story. I know something, right? So what that tells me is that word is always, it always leaves room for interpretation or mix or turnaround. But the way God uses color to communicate?
Yeah.
The way God has always kept his people in a rapture of blessing with color? With color?
Yeah. And to that point, beyond color, because color is very much emotive, but also gesture, right? Mm-hmm. When you look at this piece here, you actually see these large kind of gestural patterns that go up and down and looping. Mm-hmm. When you look at it, you somewhat imagine yourself making that gesture itself, right? That's emotive, that spontaneity in there, right? So when you're taking a look at this work, it's important, sure, to understand that the biblical narrative around it, but also just receive the work as it is. Look at it. What does it make you feel like doing? What does it remind you of? These are the signs and symbols that our forefathers, our ancestors, have set through us. Not to us, but through us. She made reference to children, right? And the multiplicity of understanding they have just intuitively, you know? Particularly women and birthing. We talk quite a bit when we
Can you go back to that the first slide that you had?
Yep, Mother of Saints.
No, the picture. I'm sorry, brother, with the black and white symbols.
The entrance.
This one.
Yeah, right there. You can stop there.
Okay.
So guys, I drew all over my notes in school. I draw all over my notes in church. I drew all over my teacher notes. I draw all over the papers. Every time I come here, when I sit at the front over there, when I'm in conversation or in a meeting, I'm drawing. My hand is moving in some sort of way. It is something that has, God bless you, has always been with me. It's one of those things that God gave me early and very young. I've always had a very neat handwriting, very trained hand, if you would. I began writing scripts when I was 3 years old because my mother taught me to. If she had taught me something else, I would have learned it, right? One of the easiest things that we can do is give our kids things that we had. And so one of the things that my nana always gave me were things to draw on. And so what I practiced often with my nana were shapes. What I taught throughout my adulthood was math. Because math and art, is a reflective language, like a circle and a square. So there are some things that I do, and then I look back into my studies and realize that perhaps someone or something is talking to me. There is a communication, there's something going on. So if you look at this right here, I'm not good with tech stuff, and I move a lot. So thank you guys for being flexible and fluid with me.
But this one right here, brother?
Right here.
Yeah, I don't know what that means at all. I have absolutely no clue at all what that means. But I see it everywhere, and I notice it everywhere. I draw it to Richard's attention. I draw it to my wife's attention. I'll draw it to your attention if we're around each other often enough. Like, I always see it. I'm like, what is that? What is that? What is that? And as I look further into my work, I also started sketching and painting in church the symbol of a flower. If I were to extend the negative space in between the shape, the negative space, the white space, is reflective closer of the symbols that I notice in my work. Mm-hmm. If you look just behind you, if you see here, you'll notice that same flower. You'll also notice it in the crook or crown or crutch in the piece behind you. It's not a flower. It's a reflection of a feeling. They are present with God. You'll also notice that shape on lots of churches. These are things that I learned post-process. It's really important that I go into process with as little knowledge of the worldly interpretation of things as I possibly can. It's very important that I turn off things like, go back to that white paper, please, or that white sheet. It's really important, thank you very much, that I turn things like this off. And the reason is because they've been so interpreted and reinterpreted and interpreted and reinterpreted. I get really fuzzy and weird and paranoid in prayer, to be honest with you. It's like, is this a space I should really trust? But it's also really, really cool. It's amazing to me. It's amazing how far we've come and how far some of these symbols are still reflected in little old Jenny, you know, my ancestors are still, they're talking to me, they're with me. Wow, thank you, Jesus. Mm-hmm. Not only are you giving me this gift, but I'm not by myself on this mountain. Like, wow, I got homies, wow, I got, it's folks under the wing with me. Like,
So, it, you know, I appreciate things like this, but in process, it's really, these are often things that I learn after, in total truth. But what does happen is I see these symbols in odd spaces sometimes, in dreams a lot, or just like, I'll keep seeing them. Driving, walking to get coffee, talking with a staff, wow, I just saw that symbol type of thing. It happens a lot, and that's one of them. But you'll notice it throughout the work. They're present with the Lord, and it is something that is pronounced on churches a lot. But it looks like a flower. It is not necessarily a flower. It's also very interesting that children readily recognize that type of symbol immediately. So here's the trick. I think if they recognize a flower and they research, or do any research, eventually, even if they don't run into my painting, they're going to run into their history, and I'm okay with that. So it's still all, it's
for the babies, you know, for the children.
And what's great is these things are reoccurring, right? We see them in logos. Sometimes we wonder why we're particularly drawn to certain things, right? The power of the movie Black Panther, right? This is the ancient script that they used. This is from an old indigenous visual language, the Ajam people, a subset of the Igbo people of Nigeria, southern Nigeria. And many of these forms and symbols were encoded not in just some of the script they had written, but even the way that they shake tables, right? The set design, like there's all kinds of analytics where if you really took the time to understand how much line, form, shape, color, volume, and texture deals with your psyche, right? This gestural abstraction makes you feel a certain way, right? Even when you go into your own home, we have interior designers, or we think we're our own interior designers, where we have certain earth tones or I'm a colorful guy, I always wear bright colors because it makes me feel a certain way, right? And it also communicates who I am. I'm a very jovial and happy person. So if I know I can encounter the world by giving off that energy, even if someone doesn't know my name, where I'm from, and what I do, they see, he's wearing this mustard yellow. He's bold, you know? They get something from it. Yeah. So we pull all of this context to challenge each of you to take a look at the work more deeply, right? As reference, as context, not as direction, right? So you can go to each work and find your own signs and symbols, your own colors, your own forms, and understand what it means to you. Because just like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they had to dig within themselves, then come together in prayer, right? Where two or three are gathered together in his name, there I will be. Scripture says they came in agreement in order to fight the good fight, right? So for us as black people in America, there's a lot we have to do together, right? This is Bed-Stuy, this is Brooklyn, this is our home. So this work isn't just about biblical narratives of them, right?
First of all, Brother Jeremiah, they lied in the story. We really got to figure certain things out, like for real. If you are, how do I say this? Y'all know how if you go into a room, it doesn't matter where you are, if I say it's Brooklyn in the house. Right?
Right.
It's like a call. It's like something God gave you. Like, it's like, it's like a call for me. It's like, you know, I appreciate that because I get nervous socially, so that helps me. You feel me? If you walk into a room and it's only white people and you're the only black person there, you notice it immediately, right? If you're the only male, you notice it. If you're the only female, you notice it, right? Okay, boom, so we're there. Let's hold that, first of all. These men, these were not boys. They were grown men, males. They were captured, right? From a village or space. They didn't necessarily know each other. They weren't necessarily friends. They weren't necessarily like homies from down, you know what I'm saying? But it's Brooklyn in the house. Like, if we all catch it, and we all in this, and I know I've seen you somewhere before, but I don't really know you. You know your mother taught you how to pray. It wasn't necessarily like, yo, pound over it and like get on our knees and here we duck. It was
wasn't necessarily that they was all on their knees and shalom and let's pray. Get that out of your head. They were more reflective of what we look like right now.
Yeah.
In need right now. Unafraid to go up to their brother and their sister and their mother and their father right now and say, I need help. Because this king is tripping. And I don't know what to do.
Well, I don't know what to do. Well, me neither.
And why you telling me what you gonna eat this food?
Yeah.
Who told you to make that decision? Y'all know somebody. Don't you know somebody? Always calling shots. And for whatever reason, that's your big brother.
Yeah.
My point is, this is a story that's yours.
Yeah.
The good Lord left it for us for a reason. But if we rely on the interpretive reflection of what's given to you about who you are, you're going to miss the hug,
yep.
The breath, your favorite song, your Lord and Savior in it. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
This, none of, at the end of the day, I want y'all to feel the spirit of the Lord when you see my work. I could care less if you know the story of Daniel. That's how they trip us up. You shouldn't go to church because you ain't read the word in a while. What? When the last time you read the word in a while? I don't know. How you not know how to read? How about you ask me about if I'm all right? And can you sit with me and tell me about this story and pray with me through this fire? God is going to meet you in that portal. God is going to meet you in the middle of that circumstance. I promise you. I promise you. Soon as you get to a space where you like, man, what the fuck is going on? I know I did this right, and I'm step right in. But if you ain't willing to get on your knees and pray, your way, not my way, your way. If you ain't willing to tell your homeboy, your homegirl what you're going through, and if they ain't willing to pray with you, hold your hand, even if they look at you crazy and do it with you, something wrong. There's a lesson in the story and the capacity of how we feel when we're together in prayer. And I was given a gift to communicate it in color and shape and form. Those are the words we use today. Who knows what they will call it tomorrow? They didn't even call us Hebrew. They wasn't even trying to say we was African. It wasn't even like, they gonna twist it up. But they can't twist up color. Blue is blue. They can't twist up my hues. They can't take the primaries from me. I live within the primaries of the Lord. I'm grateful for every single extension of color. It's a gift. They didn't always know how necessarily to write it down, y'all. Listen to the lessons that you were given, especially when they don't necessarily make sense the first time. Listen to them. Listen to your grandmother. Whether she here or not, listen, and then do the work. Get it done. Ask no questions. If she was here, you wouldn't ask your grandmama no questions. Right or wrong?
Right.
I said nothing funny. It's true. Y'all need to shake the fuck up. I'm serious. Y'all know for good and well, goddamn, that there's too much shit going on in this world for you to not remind your neighbor that it's time to get on your knees and pray. I don't do this work to just do this work, Jeremiah. I don't have to show y'all my heart and soul. I don't have to give it to Richard to give away. I don't have to do it. I do it because I understand that there's a freedom here that we all deserve. We all deserve. And if this is what the good Lord gave me to give back, then this is what I'm going to do. Now, what we also get tripped up in is when somebody don't pray like you. I'm going to go back to that point. When somebody don't call on God the way you call on God. So what? I got in the cab the other day, and the brother driving, the Uber said, God bless you, sister, in the name of Allah. I said, God bless you, brother, in the name of Jesus, and got out of his car.
Right.
Who am I to challenge that man's faith? And who am I to know that he don't call Jesus by Allah? I don't know. Who am I to know Jesus' name wasn't Allah? I don't know. And Jesus' name wasn't Jesus. We going to get to that later. We got to lean into who we are.
Right.
It's okay that this time around they call it art. Tomorrow they might call it something else. Tomorrow they might call me a freak. It may tell you I don't listen to me because I'm gay and I love the Lord. So what? So what? Because I hear him the same way y'all do. And trust me, y'all. Trust me. I pray on my knees the same way y'all grandmama taught y'all to. I ain't no different. The blue ain't different. The red ain't different. The yellow ain't, it ain't different. If you look deep into my work, you'll find my grandmama's salt. Glorious is what she calls it.
Yeah.
You see how that felt? Yeah. You see how good that feels? There's certain things that I can't necessarily write down. I struggle every time when they ask me to put this into words. It's so stupid, Jeremiah, but I got to do it. I got to deal with the formalities so they give me a shot. So that we look the part. We work very hard to get it done, don't we, brother? We work so hard to make sure that the floors are edged right, that the walls are painted properly. He takes his time, hanging every crook of every wall, of every piece. It's not for me, it's for you. It's because there's something that wakes him up. He can't explain it. He don't know what it is. And then he found something that he didn't know how to explain. And I happen to be named Genesis. So what? He still don't really know why he gave me a shot. And I don't really know why he did with me neither. But we both know we got work to do, Brother Jeremiah. How many times I called on you? You don't know me, but it's something in your gut. Something that tells you to serve the Lord properly. We ain't got to call him the right way. Y'all don't know what I dealt with before I got here. It ain't your job to know that. It's my job to deliver in the light of the Lord. That's it. Stop questioning your strength and power. Stop questioning your glue. Don't question the use in your gut. When you get up and you feel like doing it, do it. By the grace of God, you are not your own. You do not belong to you. You have a greater job to do. And it's more than just observing this work. It's paying it forward every single chance you get. However it is you've been called to serve, serve with pride. Serve like you mean it. Serve like it's gonna give you something back. Pray for your neighbor like you pray for your grandmother. Pray for your neighbor like your grandmother prayed for you. And if you're not willing to, then quite frankly, you ain't gonna get none of this. That's why how come I know that if I've been called to a black space in my hometown, we gonna be all right, Brother Jeremiah.
That's right.
Because you get it, right? Don't you get it? Y'all already got it. I don't. It's gone. I don't have anything, brother. I'm not special, brother. I ain't no angel. I ain't no prophet. I work my muck. I work hard because the Lord has called me to. It's the least I could do. Sometimes I get it wrong. Most times I do. Most times I get it wrong. Most times I get it completely wrong. And I'm completely clueless. But it's the greatest fight I've ever experienced, I promise you. I promise you. But you've got to give in to your colors, the colors that brought you here.
Yeah.
Don't exchange your color for other people. Don't trade who you know you are for other people at any point. So if they get it, Brother Jeremiah, they get it. But the Lord has already assured me that you would. That you would. There's a home for it all. There was a home for me. There's always a home for you. Always. There's always a seat. Why do I keep getting up? Because this is bigger than me. Something else needs it. Some other space needs it, obviously. I ain't crazy. But I could care less about the formalities of this. When I'm called to work, we work. That's it. God bless y'all. I think it's very, very important that we're honest with each other. That's it. Art is an honest reflection of us. When I read the word, I didn't see myself. I never see myself. But when I go on a prayer, it all looks like y'all. Mother, I've seen you before in my own self. When I take out my brains, my crown, it's chilling to me. I understand myself through these reflections sometimes, but again, most times I really don't. I really don't. It is a surrender, and I truly trust the greater gift of God. I do. I trust that I'm going to be all right.
Yeah.
And I trust that y'all are gonna put the work where it needs to go. You know what I'm saying? You're gonna do, it's going to encourage the movement that it's supposed to. It's gonna be fluid, it's gonna move through me. People have questions? I also wanted to shift the energy.
Question.
Oh, thank you. Thank you so much.
We have a question over here.
Sure, brother. Brother Martini.
What's going on, Genesis?
How are you?
I'm good. It was interesting. I was thinking about a question. I've always loved your art from 2012 when I met you.
Thank you.
And every time I look, I think I'm Nigerian, I'm Yoruba. I think Nigerian.
I'm all Yoruba.
Yes.
I think influence, were you influenced by, it's silly to say African history, culture, that's a given, mm-hmm. but more specifically, are there like tribes or people, and I was thinking about the question before you said question, and then you mentioned Igbo and Black Panther and the symbolism. I was like, wow, that was my question, and you touched on it. So influence-wise, are you influenced? Do you see that in your work?
I definitely see it, and I'm grateful when I do. Again, it reminds me that I'm not alone in a room, and it reminds me that there's space and a span for me to grow. Sometimes it's also scary to be honest with you. When those spirits or saints are present, they're larger, meaning darker, if you will. Darker meaning sort of the space for me is brighter, so it's harder for me to get closer to the canvas, if you will. So I truly can't see, if that makes any sense. It's a blind faith walk, and I'm very clear when I can't call it a tribe, but I'm very clear when I'm closer to home, if that makes any sense. And then I've also noticed that sometimes it's how do I say this? There's a So there are some tribes that I've been like really studying with, like within the Bible, that I can't find as much information on outside of, like, I can't find the biblical information that I'm looking for within the tribe, so then I get really, really frustrated within like the research, to be honest with you. And sometimes I don't necessarily feel comfortable, like I wouldn't feel comfortable necessarily asking a Nigerian man about biblical history. That's something I'm really working on, because again, we can tap each other and hug each other and love each other and learn from one another. This history is ours. And when you see something, you know, you should tell me, like, yo, Jen, did you know this is from this? Because it's a gift. And all it's going to do is expand, right? And so, like, that's the vessel part, is that you do speak, you speak a home language, right? That I don't necessarily have, that's odd. I don't have any knowledge, but we do, we all connected. So, I don't know. But the tribes that are called orphan, I will say that around the world, are orphan tribes from the western side of Africa. I would say that. And so that continues to be a blessing. People also, it's me here, because we did, like, it's really odd to me, but like, it's not odd, it's always like just very interesting to me. But people often stop me and ask me if I'm Nigerian. It's very interesting,
yeah.
Really interesting.
Yeah.
And I always answer in a very candid way, but it's, yeah, I'm not sure.
Yeah.
Are you?
Well, you know, something to both of your points that I find interesting, I'm Nigerian American, Yoruba specifically. Was born and raised here in the U.S., but I go back frequently. I was just there actually 2 weeks ago. And something that I find a lot of solace in, particularly bringing African American, Black American friends to Nigeria or West Africa when I do go, is this is biblical, a peace that surpasses understanding. They land and they feel a certain way, right? The same way blue is blue.
Right.
Blue is blue, no matter where. It could be a hue and a gradient, it could be light, it could be dark, but you still feel that it's blue. So when you're amongst your people, or you see a sign or a symbol or a texture or a color, you feel something deep within you that you can't explain, but you look to your left and you look to your right and you're reaffirmed.
Yeah.
And that's a peace that surpasses understanding. Thank you for your question. Other questions?
Your painting process, in terms of the actual execution, I'm very curious about now. I see that just from looking at it, also oil sticks, would I imagine, some spray painting. Obviously, I would imagine you sketch first. What, in terms of like how you layer your work, how do you go about the process?
Thank you so much for asking that question. You guys all hear this question. It's a really important question. I like process questions. So I don't actually sketch before I begin painting. And I don't go into the painting with knowledge of what I'm going to come out of the painting with. It really is a space of surrenderance. But when you pray, with expectation, right? So I do set up the space to be to it with intention of inviting the Holy Ghost into my space. That is intentional. So as far as I don't have to sketch because the angels are very good.
Wow.
So, they work a lot more diligently than I do. They're very fast. They're very, very good. So there are certain things that I will share with you. But a part of the reason why we add nanosalt is because it allows me to slow down the process. Because we don't drop what? Salt. Mm-hmm. We do not drop bananas what? Salt. Mm-hmm. So there are things that I have that are included in the process that allow the human to take a breath and that call the human to greater respect the discipline of the work. In the process of prayer. But as far as the layering, it's countless. I don't know quite when it begins, but when my song is on, and then the music stops. And then I go home. And then I don't. Then I turn and go on to the next work. Then I don't. Then I change my station. And then I go into writing. Then I go back into my word. Then I throw my word across the room because I don't understand how to say King Nebuchadnezzar. And I'm spelling the name wrong. I don't understand what this means. Sometimes, you pray before you read the word. What if it don't stick to you? Sometimes I'm going in and lay down, my layer of thick gesso, which is usually the first breath of baptism, if you would. Special prayer introduction, if you would. Thank you. May I paint. I don't necessarily come out with a painting. That's a blessing. Sometimes it takes a while to get in, to go back home. It takes a lot of gut. I have to leave home, literally. I literally have a conversation with my wife before going into session. I'll see you.
Real quickly, thank you for answering.
Sure.
And speaking about that, obviously with someone with a realism or surrealist artist, it's very obvious sometimes when a painting is finished. With abstract artists and expressionist artists like yourself, it's not so obvious, I would imagine. When looking at something as incredible as this, how do you know? Is it the angels that speak to you? How do you know when something's finished without taking the oil stick and doing more? How do you know when you say it's complete? Is it just something that you
just... too many questions.
Okay.
It's a human, that's something that we naturally lean on, questions. But how you want to... Wait, so I'm just supposed to be this famous, world-renowned art... Lord, I don't even know what you're even saying. and I'm teasing you and playing back with you. But, I know because the Lord tells me to stop. I knew it was time to stop because the music's talking. We are, greater is the God that we serve in us. God is that loud. And I am in, my relationship with the Lord and Savior is tight. So I'm just playing. I know. I know. I know when to start because I'm called to start. Samuel has taught me how to answer my calls, Sean. Mm-hmm. Just go and just be willing. Mm-hmm. Just hope, just get your tools ready. Because the Lord is going to stop by. So I'm really excited. Just get ready. Seriously. I put on a clean white shirt. Get ready, man. I'm excited. Lay everything out.
Yeah.
light my incense, get my tunes on, make sure my gospel's loud and blaring. I lock the door, human. Scared it was fun. But it'd be a lot of people. It's tightening. I'm getting better with turning my back. But anyway, so it's a lot in that process. It's a lot of layering. It feels very quick though. It feels like a song. But the day has gone and it's dark outside. How did I get here? You know what I'm saying? How many calls did I miss? You know how many coffees did I drink? Where was I? But I feel great, and I also feel winded and very, very hungry after painting.
Jen.
Oh, sorry.
That's great. A couple more questions here.
Sorry.
So in looking at each of the pictures and hearing the story of Daniel, but then looking at the collective, I'm wondering, is Daniel and the Hebrew boys represented in each picture or in the collective?
The collective.
Because I see in one picture, I might see, particularly there's one picture where you see so many different faces.
Mm-hmm.
So what is that representing in the story of Daniel and the Hebrew boys?
So I don't believe that we as Africans travel alone.
Okay.
I paint everybody I see and everybody I feel. I don't think that the men traveled alone. I think that it's okay to communicate to our children and that generation that we don't walk alone. You know, it's okay to tell them that the things that they see and hear when they're that young is not weird, because they know that young. So why not give it to them? Why not be honest with them? I was one of those kids who heard it. Wait, man, I don't know. Hold up, man. I was one of them kids. And unlike most people, my grandmother encouraged my questions. She encouraged my thoughts and my thinking and my sketches and my drawings. You feel me? So the story, a lot of times within my work, you'll see a band of angels, order of angels, order of spirits, if you will. They roam together. They walk together. They're together a lot. We don't walk alone. It's a lot of people. It's a lot, you know. We take up a lot of space, literally. You know, so I think that when they were in the fire, I think though King Nebuchadnezzar said, wait a minute, he looked at his bro, and he was like, hold up, I sent in three, but I see four now, you know, but I don't think that, he said, wait, he said, the fourth looks like the son of God, right, but I don't think that any son would travel alone. I don't think the Son of God travels alone, sister. Jesus always travels with the band of beautiful, harsh women. We always protect our men. Always. So when he looked in the fire, he saw the Son. He saw the Son. What he didn't see were those who were with the Son, shielding them from the fire. And my greatest opinion.
I'm going to grab a couple more questions.
That's
here.
A good question.
Yes. My son is in Nashville, but he asked me to ask you, particularly around this one, why you chose so many colors and so many lines.
Sure. So I think that there was a lot going on. The name of this piece is All the King's Men. And there was a point by which, thank you for asking that question, it's a really, really good question. And thank you for noticing the details within the work and the line structures. So there was a lot of structure within the kingdom. I played off of that a lot within displaying the king's men, if you would. You'll notice a lot of structures in the eyes and in the hair, you know, a lot of things in the ears. They had to listen to things a certain way, they had to look a certain way, you know. And so I communicated that as best I could with that line structure and sort of played around with it. It's also just something I enjoy playing around with my quote-unquote oil sticks. As far as those, if you notice up top though, with all the structures that were present, there had to be something going on, because the king looked at the king's men and he said, the king had to call one of his guys to witness the Son of Man. Like, that's something that's very interesting about the story of Daniel, is that God used the same person who God used to say,
to show disbelief and a lack of faith was the same person that created the portal of fire, which was the same person that called out and the witness of the Son. It's very interesting. And so as far as the line structure goes, I also expressed them. Can you see this up here? Do you see a bird up there? So just an expression of like freedom once he died, because unfortunately the king's men died. They all went into the pit of flames as well. But I'd like to believe that it was a freedom space for them as well. Sometimes people are called into heinous roles when you have to do things by a king or by a boss that you don't necessarily agree with and believe in, and you have to watch your brothers go for things. And so that's also a very real story. And so I'm really grateful for this piece. Thank you so much.
Awesome. We had a question back here.
Yeah, that's me. Thanks a lot for sharing.
Hi, sure.
You mentioned that your work is, for the most part, something that you're putting out into the world for other people to gain something from. Mm-hmm. But have you also, either yes or no to this question, felt like your work is also a means of you understanding yourself and your relationship with the world?
It's a means of me understanding myself and my relationship with my Lord and Savior. My relationship with the world is usually handed to me in some type of reflection that I don't agree with. I'm safer with the Lord. Mm-hmm. So it's truly an expression of prayer to God. I want to know who I am greater than God. And I really want to know who Jesus is as much as I can. I want to learn every corner and every crook and nanny of what's Jesus' favorite color? Like, Lord, like, what's your, like, do you eat cereal or do you, like, get hot? Like, I'm not joking. Like, I'm really serious. It's really, like, a space with me and Jesus. And I don't always share what I paint publicly for that reason. Sometimes it's not always a picture to show. When the reflection of that is a painting, it's a great blessing. Truly it is, because it's not always a painting. It's a really good question.
Thank you. This gentleman over here will come to you, ladies.
Congratulations to me.
Thank you.
I have one question with two parts. The depth is just inexhaustible for those of us who are appreciating it and trying to digest it.
Thank you.
I'm just wondering, is the depth related to the scale that you picked? Mm-hmm. And for those of us who live in Brooklyn with limited wall space, how might we own perhaps press?
Thank you for asking both of those questions. I dig that limited wall space. I painted across our stove and in here for a very long time. Without shame. Paint in the kitchen again. As far as the depth goes, I want to go as deep as I can every time I can. As deep as I can every time I can. I pray to get as deep as I pray to get deeper than I did yesterday. Right? Just keep digging. And as far as size goes, a piece will get boring if it doesn't keep telling the story. So, I pray that, in years to come, it's like, oh, shoot, I never noticed that. I pray that it extends that type of lifespan. And also you asked a good question about layers. Naturally, paintings appreciate, but they change. In 100 years, the painting will look very different. It will tell a very different story. I pray that my works are not restored. Gospel hymns mean something different to us than they did to our grandparents, right? So thank you for asking that. As far as availability, I don't know where Brother Richard Beavers is, but that's the guy to talk to. Richard Beavers represents all of my work, so you should talk to Brother Beavers. But thank you so much for asking. That's a good question.
Ladies, okay.
I'm so sorry, I don't mean to cut you off, sister. I really want to get in. I'm so sorry. I just wanted to tell you, brother, also that we'll be at prison this year, and I am showing you. Sorry, sister.
Can you talk about how your academic background has influenced, perhaps, in the role of your professors and your students, either influenced or detracted or enhanced your growth as an artist?
Mm-hmm. Sure, thank you for asking.
I'm big on academia. I'm a Bible nerd. I'm a nerd, period. So thank you for asking me that. I was also in education for many years. I have a great respect for teachers and a great respect for all educators, and in particular our students. It's really important to me, so thank you for asking that. I did not study art formally. I am what is considered a self-taught painter, but I am not self-taught. My grandmother taught me really well, really well. I'm very smart, and I'm very sound, and I'm very, very capable. And academically, school really came to me sort of naturally, but there were things that did not. So while schooling was natural to me, math was not natural to me. Does that make sense? But the idea of being a student was always like really, I loved it. And one of the classes that I loved was art naturally. I remember a teacher by the name of Miss Patton. God bless Miss Patton, you speak your name, Miss Patton. She was my middle school teacher. She was the first teacher who said, wow, you've got something. If you stay with me after school and during lunch, I'll help you prepare what I learned was called a portfolio. That was in middle school, that was at Satellite West. That's where I attended middle school, right here in Brooklyn. But I was considered self-taught. The reflections within the work, you know, Nana says to add a little bit more salt. So that those lessons are from home. All of these lessons are from a deeper space, which is why it's by no surprise that the order of the angel is communicating to me in a symbol. That is in a language that is spoken from back home, because the lessons are from back home. Mm-hmm. Right? So thank you for asking me that. I wouldn't say they're academic. I have applied, just so that you guys know, it's very interesting, to my scholars who are still here. I applied to Yale, and I was denied entry, probably. And I was really, really grateful. In retrospect now, but I'm still, to be honest with you, it was hard in the moment to swallow. But you know, Jade always says that rejection is protection, so I just appreciate it and kind of keep going. So thank you for asking me that. Academia around art challenges the Black ability, in my opinion, it can be limiting. Yeah. And when I say Black ability, I don't mean on campus, I mean in escape, in freedom walk, yeah, in career span. That's what I'm talking about.
But beyond art, so I actually, when I was asking about academia, I wasn't thinking about art instruction, but rather just the teachers and professors along the way you've met, how just that experience in some way has, I'm sure, shaped you and formed you as well.
Yeah, I thank you for asking that. I was really blessed to have really good teachers coming up. All my teachers encouraged me to ask questions. I can call them out. And I attended public school. I'm an advocate for public school. Sorry, I had to say that. But because I had really great teachers.
Yeah.
And then I came home to really great teachers. And then I went to church on Sunday to really great teachers. And then I went to my mom's job when she worked around only Jewish women. And they were my aunties. And they were really great teachers. They encouraged me to be a teacher. My name is a teacher. So thank you for asking me that. It's important that I get it right and that I get an A on my project. So school is important to me. It taught me to be really stern and really intentional with like when I'm called to do something. I take homework very seriously, like real nerd. Like, you know, the kid who's like, class is over and the professor's like, does anyone else have any questions? And there's that one who's like, actually, she. So yeah, I would say so. Thank you. I hope I answered your question.
So we're going to take just two more questions and then wrap things up, but we'll still be here, be able to engage a little bit further. Lady in the beautiful pink. Yes.
Hey, sister.
Hello.
I'm
not
that this is really emotionally sacred for you, this whole process.
Thank you.
So like, it's such a blessing that you share it with the world, really. And I wonder, when you're in this process, are you ever like battling God? You know, like the call is to release this work to the world, but maybe sometimes you want to keep it and you don't want to release it. How do you just pray while you're creating, or how do you work through that if you feel that way?
In prayer, I say, dear Lord, please use me. Dear Lord, please use me to give. Dear Lord, please use me. Dear Lord, please use me to give. Please use me to give, Lord. It's not mine. It's not mine to keep or hold. It's not mine. For real. Now I tithe, You gotta tithe home. I tithe home. Bless God, our church. I tithe. I said there are parts of it that you keep for self. I take care of the village. I take care of home. You know, we keep certain works, sure, for the village at home. As with expansion, it is hard to release work. It is hard. It's hard. These are my children. Seriously, I birthed the work by God. But these are mine. And so it can get hard. But the prayer is to receive and release. The prayer is to always give. A very brilliant curator once told me never to become a collector of my own work. I think that's brilliant advice. I think I heard a laugh in the rear, but I think that's brilliant advice. Always invest in yourself. So if you painted it, you should believe in parts of it and hold on to it. Careful now, right? Because if you put a price tag on it, it must be worth something. So why wouldn't you put something in your piggy bank before you release it, right? So, you know, as to be honest with you, it's not easy to see a price tag on your work.
Yeah.
I think that's an assumed space, but it's really, really not easy to put a price tag on anything that involves my space with the Lord.
Yeah.
You feel me?
Yeah.
The Lord asks that we keep the dollars out of the church. And so, yeah, sometimes it's hard. It's really hard. Yeah. So there's a lot of prayer. Mm-hmm. But Lord God, please help them to find great homes. And thank you, Lord. Mm-hmm. Thank you so much. And please help them to be a blessing to others and for others. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Mother. Wow. That's amazing. Where'd that come from? Who's that? You know? Seriously. Wow. So, yeah.
One more question.
Sorry. Thanks for asking. Hey, brother.
How are you?
Good.
Thanks so much for just sharing with us. But what's been just a question I've had is where did kind of foundation in your relationship with God come from?
Mm-hmm.
Just because you speak about identity, kind of just identity formation and how God pushes you, but also understanding the church, specifically the Black church, is how a lot of us get acquainted with Christianity.
Mm-hmm.
And historically and currently, it is so unkind to queer people.
Yeah.
And it is mind-blowing, at least for me. I'm cis hetero male, I'm Southern,
sure.
You know, Christian, the whole nine, and so understanding church or his religion are two different things.
Mm-hmm.
But how do you kind of hold on to that and nurture that when the space has been historically unkind and then take that and expand it and give it to other people?
Thank you for asking me that. That's a great question. It's also a great question to close on. Thank you for asking me that. Fortunately, the Lord has already told us that we're going to have tests. The Lord has already told us that every day is not going to be easy. That's a very hard pill for spoiled old Jen to like swallow. Wait, I'm praying to you, I love you, and you can't just make it easy? No. Right? So there are going to be some folks who just blatantly disagree with like your walk and what you do and why you do what you do. And to be totally honest with you, my wife and I have been called out of church, kicked out of church, haven't we, darling? We've been kicked out of the church, called out from the pulpit, from the pastor. I'm dressed in my finest crown. Did you just call me out from your pulpit? Did you invite us? To call us out, so it has gotten really real. But I need those. I need those are anchors. Those are anchors. I need those. And those people need me. They need us. They need our prayers. How am I really supposed to know what to pray to God for if I don't see how ugly things can get? By the way, I'm built for this. I'm from Brooklyn. I've walked into plenty of playgrounds and been told that I can't play.
Yeah.
Wait till I get the ball, though. You feel me, brother?
Yeah.
So that's a part of my walk. Like, there is no saint that has ever followed the Christ that has not been called out, spit at, knocked down. That's a part of it.
Right.
So I must be good for this.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? The saint, you don't get to be like all like, you can't be a punk and serve God.
Mm.
I call myself a Jesus freak. Mm. I mean that. You feel me? Like, that cocky edge, that's real.
Yeah.
Now, if I bring that into my painting practice, they really can't touch me, can they?
Mm.
You feel me? But I got to go into the churches, Jesus said.
Mm.
I got to go into the church. And so what turned me on was the people who turned me off.
Mm.
That shit hurt. Like, you just spit at me and my wife in church. Am I safe nowhere? Queer or not?
Mm.
I didn't even tell you I was gay. This is a Black woman. We are two Black women. Wait a minute. I pay taxes here. I am raising your children. They call me Miss So-and-so. I'm doing my job, Lord. But I got to take that. I got to. Because the Lord asked that I pray for my enemy, and I assume I don't have any often. I live in this dream of my own majesty. I'm serious. Ain't nothing gonna hurt me. I'm fine. I'm from there. I'm Sheikah. I live there. It's not true. There are literally people who are praying that I trip, fall, hurt myself, and stay there. So sometimes, you know, the Lord brings you that close so you can really see, who should you be praying for? Who should you be praying for? For real. We pray hard for that pastor in that church. Yeah. We celebrate it. We celebrate it under Stevie Wonder that night. It was hard. Yeah. It was hard. But we weren't alone. Right. And there was no apology that excuses things like that. I have to go back into the word and say, Lord, like, you know, on some peripheral, like, if being gay it ain't what it is, then strike me down, Father.
Right.
Strip it from me.
Right.
I don't need it. And I certainly didn't ask for it. So if it ain't right, Father, just come on and get me down now, today. That's a constant battle. Because I am reminded often that it must be a problem. So it is not something that I just fortify as my truth. In all relationships, there are points by which you agree with and disagree with. There are all family members that I agree with and disagree with. All of my family members love me. They don't always like me. I get that. Most men love me, they don't necessarily like me. Most women love me, they always like me. My point is, those days are really hard, but we wouldn't be here without them. I got it. I could call you. I could come have coffee with you and tell you, and you tell me, Jen, it's okay. I'm not alone. You know what I'm saying? And not for nothing. And the next time I saw him, I hugged him like he was my father. What? Like, you gonna hate me too? You the pastor, right? Now, if I call you on what you've been called on to do, so you say, then what? You can do a lot from the pulpit. Mm-hmm. Call your pastor to the responsibility they should be at. To be honest with you, I would never tithe or pay taxes or do anything with the church where I could not call my pastor today right now. I'm having a problem in my building. I got a leak. You can't call on your pastor from that place. They ain't pastoring. So once I got to that spot back to the teachers, where it's kind of like, oh, wait a minute. My good teachers look a certain way. When they stand on the pulpit, they look a certain way. They sound a certain way. They hug me a certain way, regardless of what the gospel is they're spreading, right? So I'm built for it. It's okay. God's got me there. But it hurts, brother. It hurts. And you paint with that hurt. You paint from that death. I need that. I need them to kick me down every now and again, right? I need to lean. So, I do need you to pray with me. Sometimes those faces push you close. Wait a minute, we got it. Wait a minute, there are family members who didn't like that. I thought all my family thought I was going to hell as I was gay. Wait a minute, who called us? The auntie that what? That sits on the front pew, that who? She called us over for them. So, Amen. Let him do what he gonna do. The Lord already told me, he set up like that. There's gonna be a Judas at the table, baby. Your table ain't righteous if it ain't one man. You're doing something wrong. And if you think your Judas ain't there, you sleep. You feel me? So expect that. As soon as you accept Christ, everything gonna go ahead. As soon as you accept the Lord, as soon as you step into the grace of the... Because you got to get your feathers right. You got to get your jet right. Gotta get your pack right. Gotta get your flight right. You don't even know where you're going. So you better make sure your pack is right before you take off. You feel me?
Yeah.
Except it ain't no table. It's not a table. It's a full surrender. It's a full bow. And when you're under that grace, quite frankly, I pray for him. I'm sorry, brother. I'm so sorry that you don't see how much I love you. Mm-hmm. I love you. And I love the Lord. So I'm going to do it anyway. And those experiences happen far before the successes do. Those are the building blocks. Right? Those are the teachable moments, as we call them. Right? That lets you know if you really want it. Right, brother? Now, you're going to go to church and they tell you not to. You go in the restaurants when they tell you not to. You go in the stores anyway, even though they follow you. You push those limits. You spark your flame 1,000 times to light a cigarette. The minute you open that word up and you understand, you shut it. How much you want it? So what? Y'all think it's easy, Richard being a black man in this box, owning this stock? Huh? He got to earn every hit. Every day. This shit. This is what we do. You know? And then we get to celebrate together. Yeah. You know, but it ain't always easy. But when we get to have choice, we rejoice. We give God grace for these greater moments and this hype. And then we go back into the battlefield because we've been called to be soldiers on it. Right? So we got it, brother.
We got it. So I want to take this opportunity to thank all of you for spending your Sunday afternoon, now evening, with us. And got your second sermon. Thank you so much. In addition to that, a special thanks to our sincere host, Mr. Richard Beavers. And then, Genesis, if you don't mind standing.
Yes, sir.
On behalf of the city borough president, I would like to present you with.
Can we get a picture real quick?
Sure. So many in this art chest. It's okay, we still have to just hug if you like it. No, don't hug me too tight. Not too tight.
Shut up, Richard. <Yeah. laughs>
Holding my stomach in, y'all got it. This button's about to pop. All right, thank y'all.
I want to say thank you for coming out. We really appreciate the support. Next weekend on the 23rd, we're having a free turkey giveaway here. We're going to be giving away 150 turkeys. So if you know of any family that can use a free turkey, please spread the word. Carmelo Anthony is one of the sponsors who sponsored this, so I just want to say thank you to him. And Demarius from the New York Jets also was one of our sponsors. But please, spread the word. You can go on Instagram, you'll see it on our Instagram page, Richard Beavers Gallery, and then you'll also see it on our Facebook page. But we want to give all 150 turkeys out, so any family in need, they'll come and they'll get a free turkey. So once again, thank you for being here.
Thank you.